Hello, everyone. I'm Angela Lancaster. I'm president of the Chevy Chase Historical Society, and we're delighted to have you here with us today. Before turning over the program to Mary Sheehan, who is chair of the program committee, and she'll introduce our speaker, who actually needs no introduction, but we're going to introduce her anyway. We do have a little bit of business we need to take care of, because this is also our annual meeting. So our first order of business is to elect our new board members. So nominees for members at large for the board of directors to serve a three-year term are Honor Ingersoll and Kathy Legg, who is a returning board member. So all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Congratulations, Honor and Kathy. Also at this meeting, we recognize and thank two retiring board members, Natasha Safey and Marianne Hoffman. Because our bylaws limit our board terms, both Natasha and Marianne must leave the board for 1 year. Natasha has served as nominating committee chair and gala board chair along with Susan Bollendorf. Marianne Hoffman has served as communications chair and program committee chair, and Marianne is here. I think. Where are you, Marianne? Well, we don't have to say goodbye to you yet. we just have to say goodbye to the board positions. But both of these dear friends are going to continue their work with the Historical Society, I'm happy to say. And Natasha will stay on the nominating committee and the gala committee, and Marianne Hoffman will stay on the communications committee and the program committee. We also have a new professional at CCHS. Please introduce yourself to Caroline Hayden, who, where's Caroline? She's back at the table in the back, but she is our new assistant archivist, and Caroline will be at the center along with our director, Mary Ferranti, to help researchers and to answer questions from the public. The center is open to the public on Tuesdays from 10 to I'm sorry, it's 9 to 12, and no, it's not. It's 10 to 12 and 1 to 3, I should know these, and at other times by appointment. All right, the second order of business is that on your chairs you have an evaluation form. If you would please fill it out after the lecture, we will collect them, and then we'll have a drawing for a prize. And today's prize is Steve Roberts' book, Bethesda and Chevy Chase, which uses a bunch of photographs from the Historical Society. So we hope you'll fill out the forms for us, and I'll ask you to pass them to the center after the lecture. Somebody will collect them, and we'll do a drawing. All right, the third business matter is at the back of the room is an annual report for the Chevy Chase Historical Society for 2016. Please take a copy if you're interested. Also at the back of the room are refreshments, which we hope you will enjoy following the lecture and the Q&A. And now, to introduce our speaker, drum roll please, is Mary Sheehan.
Welcome again, everyone. Thank you for coming. Our speaker today, Dr. Gail Sansbury, brings us a fresh and fascinating new look at the earliest residents of Chevy Chase. She will explore how reading groups formed by residents of the new suburb created a cultural and intellectual foundation for the young community, as well as civic ties that continue to characterize our community today. Gail holds a bachelor's degree and a master's degree in American history from the University of Rhode Island, and another master's degree and a doctorate in urban planning from UCLA. She moved to the Washington area after retiring from a career as an educator in the California State University system. There, she was a member of the planning faculty at Cal Poly Pomona, teaching planning history and urban design. She also taught in the American Studies program at San Jose State University, in the Cultural Studies program at California College for the Arts, and in the Women and Gender Studies program at San Francisco State University. Her research, writing, and speaking engagements have focused primarily on urban and community history, women's history, and housing history. Gail is already familiar to many of you, as Angela indicated. We are proud to say that she was the director of the CCHS Archive and Research Center up in the Chevy Chase Library for almost 5 years until her retirement this past fall. Among her myriad contributions to the CCH during those years were important additions to our online exhibits. These exhibits weave together individual records from our archive as well as original research into cohesive, entertaining, and educational presentations that tell the stories of our community's past. Our website, ChevyChaseHistory.org, features 8 online exhibits, and we have Gail to thank for many of those. The exhibit topics range from the old Chevy Chase Lake Amusement Park to the former Chevy Chase Junior College and to neighborhood newspapers that were published by local children in the 1930s and 70s. Well, today we celebrate the launch of a new online exhibit titled Chevy Chase Reads. This is the most recent exhibit that Gail has developed for CCHS. The handout on your chairs gives you a little preview of that exhibit, and Gail will tell us much more. But we invite you to visit our website and enjoy all of our informative and user-friendly online exhibits. So with that, please welcome me, please join me in welcoming Gail Sansbury.
Thank you. It's great to be here, and I'm so excited this project is ready for you to see online. It's been a labor of love and taken some time. Some of you have probably given me material and wonder, whatever I did, what did I do with it? But it's all there now, so thank you. As I said, I'm really happy to be here. And I know you have the little flyer that Mary talked about, which gives you the link to the website. And that's where you can see in actually even better resolution than I'm going to show you today, some pictures of the early residents and all the information about their book clubs. But before I do that, I want to just say that many, many people, a whole community, really, of CCHS board members and graduate interns, volunteers, as well as the grandchildren of many of the people that we wrote about, that we did this research about, have helped us so much over the last few years. It was really begun in 2013, so it's a long time that we've been working on it. I want to take this opportunity, though, right now, to thank my co-researcher and writer, Bob Andrews. He is an expert in genealogical research and a wonderful writer, too. And the exhibit really would not have been completed without his many, many volunteer hours. So please join me in thanking him. Thank you, Bob. Well, we did our historical research using the materials right in our archive. So except for historical newspapers and genealogical websites, you know, our research is based on documents that you can come and look at, actually, right? If you're interested in any of these and holding them in your hand, perhaps even. The three organizations, again, I'll probably repeat this many times, are the Chevy Chase Free Library Association, founded in 1896. That's the first one I'll talk about. The second one is the Chevy Chase Reading Class, an all-women's organization in 1899, and the Literary Club of the Chevy Chase Association, which was founded in 1906. Okay. So before I get to those, the first group, I wanted to talk a little bit more about Chevy Chase. You know, I know many of you are really familiar with the development, maybe from other lectures like Steve Roberts last fall or John Ferrari's lecture on streetcars. So this is just a quick review, but it's really important because it helps give a context, and you know, I'm a planner, so I want you to know, make sure that you have the same sensibilities about it that I have. So in 1890, the Chevy Chase Land Company was founded by Francis Newlands and his partners, and they bought up land to create the Rock Creek Railway, which would bring people to the new home lots they wanted to develop as an extension of Connecticut Avenue. So the map that you see here was created in 1892. It seems fanciful to us today because it doesn't actually represent accurately where the streets are. It was a sales map, however, for the first one to sell lots. However, 1892 was the year it was published, but in 1893, there was a depression in the United States, and that meant that land sales were much slower than the Chevy Chase Land Company expected. So by the time that the Free Library Association was founded in 1896, there were really only 27 houses in Section 2, which was the first subdivision to be developed. So only 27 houses. By 1901, when the library itself opened, there were 49. And by 1915, there were 175 houses. So we're really looking at this really early period as it's being developed. And you have to imagine literally vacant lots, okay? This is what the period that the whole exhibit covers. Now, the streetcar line, again, for people, just as a refresher for all of us, you know, starts from, is an extension of Connecticut Avenue, so it starts from downtown, and it goes across the state line, as you can see, and it bears due north right at Chevy Chase Circle. The Village Hall, on this closer view of Connecticut Avenue in Maryland, shows that the Village Hall, where we are right now, right, is just two blocks above the circle. And here you see the boundaries of Section 2, and everybody who lives in Chevy Chase Village knows this all well. But for visitors from outside of Chevy Chase, I want to make sure that you understand that this is just a tiny portion of what would later be developed by the land company. So when the land company sold these house plots, there were restrictions within the deeds. There covenants or restrictions. It's a kind of proto-zoning at that time period designed to maintain the value of each lot in the new development. So it was by design that there would be residential land uses only, no commercial development. The houses would be single family. A 25-foot setback from the street. This would be a big difference from row houses close to the sidewalks in the District of Columbia. And very important, no alleys. No alleys. This is a typical progressive era response to the characterizations of alleys in the cities, of course, which were seen by people then as sites of disease and impurity and home to communities of color and newcomers, right? And so that was thought to not be a good thing to have alleys at all. So there are none here. The houses built along Connecticut Avenue, and I hope you can see, I tried to highlight those lots right on either side of the avenue. They were also required to be of a value, the construction, of not less than $5,000, which is a fair amount of money then, and probably some of them, the grander houses, would cost much more. But by contrast, the houses on the side streets had to have a minimum value of $3,000. So you see how these covenants or restrictions kind of shape who can afford to live in Chevy Chase. We know, by the way, that the early residents who were active in these three organizations mainly lived on the side streets, right? They weren't the grand people, of course. But to get back to the zoning aspect, in these early deeds, there were no explicit racial or religious restrictions. You could say there did not need to be. They were controlled by the developer and the real estate agency, and so anyone deemed undesirable by them simply would not be able to execute a deed with them. They wouldn't be able to sell to them. A few years later, though, there were explicit racial restrictions in deeds for lots that the developer Harry Martin sold for his additions to Chevy Chase. And I have to say that in later years, particularly in the 30s, in other parts of Chevy Chase, racially restrictive covenants were included. Now, all of those became unenforceable by the Supreme Court decision in 1948. Nevertheless, this is an important legacy to recognize about the community. So the new suburb, In the 1890s, the first residents of Chevy Chase found themselves in, as you can imagine, a new and relatively remote subdivision from few community-based institutions. Many of them had lived in the District of Columbia before moving here. And again, by design, no schools, no churches, no stores, no truly community space, no public space. There were three exceptions, but they were all privately owned. Two here that you see are the Chevy Chase Club, founded in 1892. It was built as an amenity for the development, but only wealthy families would have qualified for membership. A hotel opened in 1894, the Chevy Chase Hotel, sometimes called the Chevy Chase Springs Hotel. And again, it was built by the land company to attract prospective buyers, and it did a good business in the pleasant weather of the year, but it wasn't a good round year business, and it later became a private school for young women. Now, there's another institution that we might think of as being more public, was the Chevy Chase Lake Amusement Park. You know, and this popular amusement park at the end of the line, opened in 1894, offered boating and concerts and dancing and even pony rides. But it was privately owned. And even though it drew patrons from all around the DC metropolitan area, any place that someone could get to from on a streetcar, really, could come, but not everyone was allowed to enter. The streetcar ticket did not guarantee a ticket to Chevy Chase Lake. Although the streetcar trolley system, as you remember from John Ferrari's lecture, was not segregated, people of color were turned away at the amusement park. For example, the Washington Post reported on a black couple from the District of Columbia who were refused entrance in August of 1898. So more about these first residents. Well, first, most were from the rising middle class. The ones on the side streets I'm talking about now, not the people who inherited great sums of money or were maybe more formally attached to the Gilded Age. These households they were white, first of all, as we've established. Most of the participants in the literary groups were married. There were some single men and women, but most were married. A high proportion of both men and women were college graduates, and that's important, right? And their secure economic status came through at least someone in the household working in the growing government bureaucracy or in professional services. So let's start with the free library. It's the earliest of the three groups, founded in 1896. Now, the early fundraising was done by women. Now, historians looking at the public library movement across the United States have claimed that 75% of the groups advocating for these libraries were initially led by women, but once the library gets set up, men take over. Oh, but Chevy Chase was no different. And one of the reasons, there are many reasons for this. I'm afraid to go off on a tangent on that, but I won't. But according to Chevy Chase resident from this period, Thomas Robertson, in a brief history that he wrote in 1945 and published in a local paper, the Free Library Association was founded by Edith and Janet Newlands, the daughters of Senator Francis Newlands, and their friend Alanceta White, the daughter of the Burneys who lived on West Kirk Street. The three friends were debutantes in this period, and they also had this idea to advocate for libraries. The Newlands daughters, you'll remember, have inherited their mother's share of the Comstock load, and their father, Francis Newlands, was the trustee for the fortune made in those silver mines, and of course the developer of Chevy Chase. So it must have made a big difference that they could pressure their dad to donate land for the library. But the first president that I would have been able to record is Miss Janet Richards. She's one of the single members of these organizations, and I'll describe her in a minute. But I want to continue with what Mr. Robertson wrote. He said, in order to purchase books, this association met once each month at the homes of the residents and thus not only raised funds, but brought about social gatherings of the neighbors. So it was, it's nothing new for me to say that they created a community by these associations. People knew that was what was happening. Well, Miss Janet Richards herself was a well-known author, lecturer, and you know, she was a traveler. She would travel and then come back and make lectures for large audiences. These were illustrated presentations, and they were around the city and in other cities. She lived with her parents on West Kirk Street when she wasn't traveling. And in 1897, she's identified as the president of the Free Library Association. And in this Washington Post article about a fete that's being planned, that's going to be at her family's house, the event is free, but everyone was asked to make a donation of a book. Well, things moved quickly under the leadership of women, right? The construction of the library begins when even before, or the idea, the planning for the library building comes even before Frances Newlands and the land company donate the property that where we are right now. It's called Block 37. In 1900, architect Waddy Wood published plans for the Chevy Chase Library in the American Architect and Building News. Now, many architectural historians have said that Arthur Heaton was involved in it, and he may have had a part in it. Both Wood and Heaton were collaborating on All Saints Church at this very same time, so perhaps that's the connection. But in any case, these plans that were published in 1900 show the original the floor plan and the elevation and include this rendering. Now, Frances Newland donates the land in January of 1901, and by December of that same year, what may have been the first public event in the new library, Miss Janet Richards gave a lecture about Yellowstone Park. The Free Library Association, though, was not finished with fundraising. Nope. They had to pay off a debt. They had a debt fund. And one of them was the 1903 Country Fair. And it was reported on almost every newspaper in Washington, D.C. They had a fabulous publicity committee, Marianne Hoffman. They did a great job of getting all the information out. And this, in the larger type, you can read a report by the Washington Post that says that they already had 500 books and other reading material in the library. But, you know, although women were key in that initial fundraising, once the library was operating, men were elected to leadership positions. And this same article shows that that they were holding those positions. This is really common in lots of nonprofit kind of institutions or community institutions, and you can find similar stories all around the D.C. metro area and really across the United States. But as I will discuss in a moment, many Chevy Chase residents, both men and women, were advocates for women's rights to vote and women's rights in general. So this is not a reflection of their efforts in those areas. Another really interesting fundraiser was an opera written by the residents, written and performed by them. It was called, I love what they call themselves, the Royal Italian Opera of Chevy Chase. And I only wish that we had the libretto and the music for this, right? Now, Hattie Howard on the left, she wrote the music. She wrote music as well as sang, and she obviously was part of this event as well. But local newspapers recounted her performances at various benefits, and one of my favorites is a benefit for the women's clinic in the district, in which she gave a wonderful whistling solo. But she actually had a really wonderful voice as well, and she's a published songwriter, as Bob Andrews can attest. We've found her songs. Eugene Stevens was a longtime member of the Washington Choral Society, active in the Musical Arts Society, and the Capitol Glee Club. He was well known in D.C. just as Hattie was. Both of them, interestingly enough, I'm going to switch to their spouses in the next slide just to touch on some of that women's votes part. Their respective spouses, Gertrude Stevens and Clifford Howard, were both strong advocates for women's suffrage. Gertrude and Eugene Stevens, before they moved to Chevy Chase, had supported suffrage for the residents of Washington, D.C., both men and women, right? And Gertrude, she was a graduate of Mount Holyoke, was a member of the State Equal Suffrage League. She was also a teacher in the D.C. public schools, I should say, before she had children. But with others, she was part of a very large group of about 100 people, 100 women, who met with President Wilson in 1915. After the 19th Amendment was ratified, she was chosen as a delegate to the Maryland Republican Convention. She ran for elective office in 1926. She didn't win, but she remained involved, very involved, in county and state politics for the rest of her life. Now, Clifford Howard, Hattie's husband, was a lawyer and writer. He was well known for his support, again, for the vote for D.C. residents, for both men and women there, but also for women across the country. In the 1895, before the Howards moved to Chevy Chase, he wrote a poem especially for the Women's Suffrage Association, and he had many other books that I've listed that are on the slide. Hattie and Clifford eventually moved to California, where he began writing for the movie industry, but he continued to write books about women's suffrage, pamphlets, and many things to support that movement. Now, the last fundraising event that I want to tell you about is the masquerade party at the Stevens House. They had many fun events, as you can already tell. But in this one, Eugene and Gertrude Stevens invited everyone to their house for a masquerade party in February, and it was February 1906, on a Wednesday night. And it was like, so that's a school night to me. The guests danced from 10 p.m. to midnight, and I'm sure no one left because the prizes for the best costumes were not awarded until after then. Now, on the left, you see Fanny Richards. She was active in the Free Library Association, and she's going to play a strong role in the women in the reading class. But she's wearing a beautiful dress in this family photograph. But that's not what she wore to the party. In fact, she went as a mummy. And it's and because she said not a word all evening, she won a silver nut dish. Yes. This is what planners would call conviviality that builds community, right? You know. what happened to the Free Library? Well, I would say that it was a success. Right? It met its goal. It served its purpose. In 1906, the Free Library merged with the Chevy Chase Citizens Association. That was an association of residents that had been founded just 1 year before the Free Library Association, actually. Together, they became a new organization, the Chevy Chase Association. And I want to quote from Mr. Robertson's 1945 news article again. He wrote, "The library building became the center of the civic meetings of the village." And I think to say that continues today. And among the things that Mr. Robertson mentioned was that in 1912, the library building became a voting precinct, and that meant that residents no longer had to travel to the old blacksmith shop in Bethesda to vote. One of the questions that I've had over the last few years is, where do people go to the library? Do they continue to go to the library here? It's a little fuzzy for me, but you know, in the later years, the Chevy Chase DC branch opened in 1927, and the Bethesda branch opens. It's not until 1965, of course, that the Chevy Chase current library opens, but I think they had plenty of access to books. Today, the building that we're in today is probably best known as the Village Hall. But in newspaper announcements from the 20s to the 30s, when we were doing research about this, we would see little announcements of programs, And many described the place of whatever meeting was going to be held here as the old Chevy Chase Library. And these would be announcements for meetings, dances, church services. There were many church services held here when people were waiting for their own church to be constructed, things like that. So I think our meeting here today, the one for the Historical Society and many others you've probably attended, it really continues the long tradition of civic meetings in this space. Now I want to talk about the reading class and the second group. It was founded in 1899 by four women. They had all been active in the Free Library Association. Let me show you pictures of them. Because we have the leather-bound minutes for the first 25 years of the reading class, we know quite a bit about their early days, what they read. So we have to infer really what was going on, but what they read, for sure we knew. And they called this book, this leather-bound book that you see on the slide, the Outline History of the Chevy Chase Reading Class. We've transcribed it so you can read it as part of the Chevy Chase Reads exhibit. Elizabeth Verrill, Mary Robertson, Grace Bowen, and Fanny Richards were the founders. They began meeting at each other's homes every week between October and May to discuss books, primarily works of English literature. They were inspired to begin the reading class after Elizabeth Verrill learned about a similar group from a friend who was visiting from another city. Elizabeth Verrill seems to have been then the primary founder and looked up to as the leader for many, many years. She planned the annual programs until she finally said, no, you have to take over and do this too. She was very well educated, but we don't know where she went to school. We've tried to find out so much more about her. But we know, for instance, that she frequently translated things that she read from French for the other members, things like that. After her first husband died, she worked as a clerk in the Department of Labor to support herself and her young son. There she met her second husband, Charles Verrill, and after their marriage, they moved to Chevy Chase. Sadly, she died of tuberculosis in 1914, and the minutes of the group include a beautiful, beautiful tribute to her and her leadership, and they described what she brought to the group and to them and their friendship. It was a kind of work, the work they did in the reading class, that was both a pleasure and a profit. Now, Mary Robertson, who may well have written that tribute, was one of the four founders, and she was a graduate of Bates College, the daughter of abolitionist missionaries who helped start Storer College in Harper's Ferry. It provided teacher training for freed men and women after the Civil War. Mary herself taught there after college, and then she moved to Chevy Chase after marrying Thomas Robertson, a patent lawyer. Grace Bowen was Mary Robertson's sister-in-law, that is, Thomas Robertson's sister. Grace married Jesse Chester Bowen, a lawyer and statistician, who worked at the Department of Labor. The Robertsons and the Bowens were very close. They were family, but they also had houses back-to-back to each other in one period. And in other periods, they all lived in the same house, so they were very close. And they were both families were founding members of All Saints Episcopal Church. Fanny Richards was an elementary school teacher in the Orient Point neighborhood of Boston at the time of her marriage to Cliff Rogers Richards. He was a graduate of Boston University who later worked for the Department of the Interior until his retirement. So those are the first four people. And now we go to a brief report about the second year of the reading class. They decided that they would expand. They would double in size. They were going to invite four other women to join them. Mary and Helen Childs, who were the adult daughters of the rector of All Saints Episcopal Church. Helen Tucker, also a member of All Saints, was asked to join. Again, it shows that how the different ties, in this case, between religion and these reading groups overlap and reinforce each other. Fanny Richards was not an Episcopalian. She attended the Universalist Church on 16th Street in the district. They continued to read challenging works, but I want you to look closely at this last paragraph. I don't know if you can read it, but I'll read it here. Each member would lead the discussion on a specific author or work. The meetings are held from 11 to 12:30, so 90 minutes. And then luncheon was abandoned. Right. And these three little words just touched me so much. They were really serious about their intellectual work. These meetings were truly classes. That's why it's not called a book club, right? It's a class. It was really serious. These were not social events, or not just social events. So here's some of the readings for the first year. You can see some of all of this on our website, and we have a list of everything that they read that you can browse, perhaps add to your own reading list, right? All right, well, where did they live as a planner? I always want to know that. And here's where those first four women lived. And the two stars that are really quite close right here, the Robertsons and the Bowens live right close to each other. And remember, this was in the period where there were less than 50 homes in Section 2. By 1905, many more women joined the reading class, and there were 14 in all. They were able to walk to meetings, although we would consider it maybe dangerous today to cross busy Connecticut Avenue, right? It was easy for members of the reading class to walk just a few blocks to each other's homes. Helen Tucker, in both photographs, one of her reading at home and one of her in, dressed up for winter weather outside her house, she appears like she's ready to walk to a friend's house, perhaps. She lived at Brookville and Lenox. This photograph, sometimes I show this photograph first because it was one of the inspirations for trying to do more of this research. Who were these women, right? It was taken around 1905. We've been able to compare with a similar photograph that is at the Montgomery County Historical Society. Evidently, everyone who was a member got a print, right? So there probably are others around. And we identified people because we know from the outline history who were members in that year. So we're pretty sure it's 1905. But they are holding little posies or have them stuck in their dresses. And so we think there may be some occasion for this. We think maybe it's a fifth anniversary. I don't know if this is going to show up today, but I drew little circles around the founders. Sitting in the front in the white dress is Mrs. Verrill. And I think maybe she got that center seat because of the great esteem they all had for her. Now, they read different things over time. Their themes evolved. At first, it was English literature, then Shakespeare. And they continue to return to the works of Shakespeare. People who've written about book classes and book clubs in this time period say that there were many groups of women reading Shakespeare. It was quite common. And you couldn't go wrong, could you, really? But they also often read poetry, and they began to read books that had achieved some popular acclaim, such as those by Nobel Prize winners. You know, the Nobel Prize begins to be awarded in 1901, and these were curious and women. They wanted to read this work that had won a prize. They also read popular American fiction, as well as translations of non-English literature. One whole year was devoted to the literature of the Far East, a program developed by Fanny Richards. And by their 25th anniversary, they were reading books on psychology and politics and books about the immigrant experience in the United States. And you see this on this slide. That was their reading list that year. G. Stanley Hall and Havelock Ellis, for instance. There's many other names that you'll see and recognize, but Anzia Yezerska reminded me of something that I assigned to American Studies students many times. Her writings about her experience as an immigrant from Eastern Europe in the 1920s. So they celebrated their 25th anniversary at the Robertson's house with our husbands as our guests, they wrote in their minutes. there were membership rules, and at a certain period, I'm not quite sure when this started, they prepared little annual program pamphlets that listed the meeting dates, the topic, and the assigned leader of the day. And at the back of each one of these little annual booklets was a list of rules. They say pretty much the same, but it was more about things about how people were chose. No one could become a member if there was any one vote against them. But I think it was all worked out. I can't believe that it was not a good process. Membership was, however, limited to 20. They figured out what was the right group to have a good conversation and maybe, you know, fit comfortably in their homes as well. Number 7, however, kind of refines this idea about membership, because it says that Chevy Chase should be understood to mean any outlying district of that name. So it wasn't just Section 2, right? It meant that you might live, I assume, in Martin's Addition to Chevy Chase, or maybe even North Chevy Chase. You could still come to meetings in the village. And it shows that the founders retained a little bit of power, or at least the convenience of not having to leave or go too far from their homes. Now, switching a little bit about the women and their families, is that many of them had young children. And it's just interesting to us that there was a kindergarten in Chevy Chase, D.C. at Klein's Bakery. And actually, a number of the reading class members' children are in this photograph. You can look at it in more detail on the website, but we don't know when it operated, the time it operated, or, you know, maybe it overlapped with the weekly meeting, but that I don't have any information about that. But it's wonderful that they were in this picture together. But how did people take care of their children when they went to meetings, or when they just needed time to read their assignment? According to the 1900 and 1910 census data, only 5 of the reading class households had live-in domestic servants. And again, that may be a reflection of class and the side of the wealth of these households and the size of their homes or whatever. Many others would have domestic servants, we believe, who lived out. But one of the households that had live-in servants were the Tuckers. You saw the picture of Mrs. Tucker with her great, beautiful muff and hat, right? The Tuckers were hired Alice Clater, shown here with the Tucker's daughter, Jean, in the middle photograph. Alice Clater worked for the Tuckers for at least 10 years as a nurse and a maid. The Tuckers also had a live-in cook. And it's clear that while Helen enjoyed being with her children, she also liked to read in solitude, so it was probably great to have Alice there so she could sit in that comfortable chair. As I said, other reading class households may have had domestic servants who lived out, who traveled most likely on the streetcars to their houses. And they may have lived in the district. They may have lived in the historically black neighborhoods, like Hawkins Lane, or even now as we read in the newspapers about the settlement in River Road. This is the history that we really should try to find out more about. And if we can't for the people who lived at this turn of the century period, we should make sure we're really capturing the history and experiences of people who work in Chevy Chase now. At any rate, you can read more about Alice Clater on our online exhibit. But to state the obvious, we really wish we had more information about everyone who worked in Chevy Chase households. Many of the reading class members had the time and the freedom from childcare or other responsibilities to be involved in voluntary organizations. And in this progressive era, women become very active in various organizations, particularly related to urban centers. I just chose 2 as instances to they both focus on the needs of children and mothers. It's kind of interesting. The Mothers' Congress was not so much a charitable organization, but an advocacy group. It was founded by a Chevy Chase resident, Mrs. Burney, mother of Alancita, She was a former journalist and writer. She worked with philanthropist Phoebe Hearst, you may have heard of, to bring experts and interested members of the public together to discuss the needs of mothers and children, and particularly ideas about education. Both Elizabeth Verrill and Grace Bowen attended these and volunteered at these multi-day conventions that were held several times in Washington, D.C. The eventual outcome of these conventions was the creation of what we now know as the PTA, the Parent Teachers Association. It merged with another group that was operated on similar grounds, but was an African-American group. Now, the Florence Crittenden Mission was a national organization that helped support local homes for unwed mothers. Their fundraising structure involved the creation of local circles, Crittenden circles, or sometimes they gave them a particular name in their neighborhood. And this, the idea of the circles was an innovative organizing strategy, we might say today, a grassroots strategy. Many women in Chevy Chase participated in these circles or started their individual circles, raising money for the home in D.C., which sheltered mothers and their children. Mary Robertson did more than that, though. She was the president of the Lady Managers who ran the home, and she was involved with it for many, many years, and also a well-regarded person in the national, at the national level, who spoke at conventions and wrote reports and things like that. So both the Mothers Congress and the Crittenden House are examples of the remarkable achievements of women in the public realm, all while staying technically within prescribed gender roles. Now, over the years, we know the reading class continued to meet, and certainly into the 1960s, as this newspaper article shows from January 1962. It's Mary Robertson and Harriet Ashley, who joined the reading class in 1909, are in the front row of that picture. So Mary Robertson, at this, she died in 1962, so you can imagine she was attending meetings since 1899. But announcements of the reading class meetings no longer appeared in local papers on a regular basis, so we can't track what happened exactly to the group. It's partly due to the changes of the way newspapers reported social news. If you've seen the old newspapers with huge spreads of all the social events, you know what I mean, that doesn't happen anymore. So we don't know if it continued as a group called the reading class, whether it operated under another name, like the Wednesday morning group, or what exactly happened. Maybe a reading class is at the Women's Club, for instance, which had been founded in the 1930s by women in Martin's edition. Never mind, 60 years is enough for me, because I think their persistence, if I can use that word, as a community of readers is really inspiring today. Their reading programs document a commitment to the continuing education of women, as well as the power of reading and discussing literature in a group. All right, so these same women who were part of this wonderful reading class are going to become members in the last group I talk about, the Literary Club of the Chevy Chase Association. We'll talk about that now. The Literary Club of the Chevy Chase Association included both men and women. It only met once a month, but still October to May. There were a variety of monthly programs, original essays, fiction written by members, it's read aloud, sometimes excerpts from works by published authors, and poetry was really frequent, as were musical interludes, and sometimes the evening ended in social dancing. Right? So, as with the outline history of the reading class, minutes were kept at each meeting in a ledger shown here. Officers were elected each year. Both men and women served, although mostly men were in the early period were the chairs, but women played key roles. And refreshments, I think, were of the lightest sort. This was the exact words they used. So they weren't distracted again by that. And there were no dues, but you had to be a member of the Chevy Chase Association. I'd love to know more about the Chevy Chase Association, and maybe there's some records here at the town hall that can help us know more. But at any rate, The minutes showed that lots of visitors also came to some of their meetings. So even though it's both men and women, I don't have a picture of them together, right? But I have this picture of the men that's sort of like for the other side. You remember the picture of the women? And they were all involved in this group, almost all of them that were in that picture. And most of these men were too. Bob Andrews has written these wonderful short biographies of all of the members that he can have, that he can find information on, of the members of the literary club. And you can just click and get a little short paragraph or several paragraphs. The men in this photograph, well, this photograph, there's several, again, like the photograph of the women, there's several copies of this. They must have made multiple copies for everyone in it. And it had a funny, caption called Honorary Economical Epicureans. And when I first came to the Historical Society, I talked to people about this. They said, we think that we have a men's cooking group, and isn't that cool, right? And it would have been cool, and maybe it was. I don't know. I don't think so, though, because in the course of doing the exhibit, the great-granddaughter of Mary Robertson asked me if we wanted to scan her copy of the same photograph. And on the back of her photograph, it said, this was a joke photograph made by the men for their women. That's why they called themselves honorary, because they benefited from their wives' delicious and inexpensive meals that they took turns making. So I think that may be the real answer. But anyway, you get to see what the men in the group looked like, and you can learn about each one of those men, almost all of them. There's a little bio. All right, so Eugene Stevens, back again as a leader. And he, in 1909, wrote a very detailed program committee report. In addition to the regular essays and stories, he endorsed the novel idea of a composite story. These were created by several people. Like, you'd write a portion of each story. It apparently was on some general plan, perhaps, the name of a character, perhaps. I'm not sure. But I get the feeling that when it was read aloud at meetings, it often resulted in humorous, shall we say, juxtapositions, right? I don't know. Things probably were funny. So again, the kind of conviviality and shared creative process, I think, is important about this group. One of the people who really liked to do this was Fanny Richards' husband, Clift Richards. He wrote a lot of original stories that he read, but he also wrote the composite stories with Harry Giovannoli and C.D. Parker. One little note that's interesting. These are the things we don't know how to understand. And so maybe one of you can help us in the future. In 1910, while chair of the Chevy Chase Association, he proposed that the literary club separate from the Chevy Chase Association. We wonder why. We just don't know. It doesn't show up in the minutes. We don't know why. Well, what shows up is that the proposal was tabled. So that's it. Curious. Now, I want to talk about one particular meeting, and I don't know how my time is, I'm probably going over, but, okay, so we're nearing the end of this, but, so I won't, I'll make this really limited. On the website, we have a pretty detailed investigation, you might say, of this meeting, in which we talk about the authors who they read. This particular meeting was held at the Weaver's House. There were lots of people there, as you can see, 28 members, 15 visitors. And it featured several presentations on fiction, poetry, and songs about or by African Americans. And some of the authors, caught our attention. Again, I refer you to the online exhibit because I think it's really interesting. Paul Lawrence Dunbar is the African American acclaimed poet, who lived in D.C. Before he died in 1897. He was the first poet to read at the Library of Congress, and many people many accounts in the newspapers are people reciting his verse both sometimes in dialect and sometimes not. He made a choice to write in dialect sometimes. The other two people, Joel Chandler Harris, because he he was a newspaper reporter, a white man from Georgia, I believe, Uncle Remus stories. And Thomas Nelson Page, is more famous today as someone who was an apologist for the Old South in Old Virginia. His book makes the case that the South was much better before the Civil War and Reconstruction. Well, so we kind of wondered what Mary Robertson and Gertrude Stevens might have thought about this if they were at the meeting. We don't know. But both of their parents were missionaries or worked in the Freedmen's Bureau, and they might have quite different views of Thomas Nelson Page. And it turns out that just before this particular meeting, Page had been elected president of the National Society of Fine Arts. So he was a prominent figure in D.C. Again, you can look at that and look at some of the of their, learn more about each of those three authors' work on our website. So let me advance. So the minutes are silent. Silent on Jim Crow. It's not that we expected to find this in here, but this is the context that we're talking about, right? And there were many events that must have concerned the residents in Chevy Chase, members of the Literary Club. They gave papers on all kinds of public policy issues, agriculture by Mr. Teal from the Agriculture Department, or debates on tariffs for the new Panama Canal, things like that. But there isn't anything about racial segregation, or any of the well-publicized controversies about housing. And in fact, on our website, you can read more about an effort to build, to sell lots to African Americans in a property really adjacent to Chevy Chase, Section 2 at Western and Wisconsin Avenue. That plan was stopped, I believe, primarily because of the resistance of white residents of Friendship Heights. And again, we covered that in the online exhibit, so I won't go into that. Some of the Chevy Chase residents who work for the federal government would soon experience firsthand, perhaps, in their job as senior members of government departments when under the Woodrow Wilson administration in 2013, the federal workforce is resegregated. And 1913. All right, so just as a last slide, primarily about them, is that really that meeting that seemed almost an anomaly, but and maybe it wasn't. It was just another meeting to delight people about literature that they cared for or were interested in. So you see they had a great time dancing after one of the meetings. People read in an entertaining way. Mr. Curtis, for instance, gave a wonderful presentation about the national parks. And they were all pleased to know about this Western saying, "See America first." So the last meeting was 1914 in December, and we don't know again what happened. Whatever that issue was about leaving the Chevy Chase Association, was there something to that, or did they just stop meeting? We're not sure, so we'd love to be able to find out, and maybe we will learn about this. But the legacy, I think, doesn't depend on that. The legacy of the early Chevy Chase readers and writers is so important, I think. Despite the gaps in our history of the groups, I think that it's so important that the first truly public building in Chevy Chase was really built through their efforts and advocacy, and through the social networks that they built on their love of books and reading. They went on to build other community institutions, schools, churches, municipal governments, and today local groups do continue this this great tradition. So the last slide is a quote from someone who actually lived in Martin's edition, but it's such an apt quote, I want to use it anyway. His mother was a member of the reading class at one time. And he writes, "A neighborhood is relatively easy to specify on a plat, but the sense of community therein resides in the quality of life given by its inhabitants. The members of these three groups made exceptional contributions to the quality of life in early Chevy Chase. With a foundation based on their love of books and reading, they were true community buildings and an inspiration to us all. Thank you. Yes.
With regard to your last slide and the explanation of neighborhood, I noticed that on the earlier slide of the reading club, that there were a couple of stars on the DC side of Western Avenue.
Yes.
Does that mean that we could infer that there was a willingness to include the Chevy Chase DC as part of the neighborhood of the larger Chevy Chase?
That is a great question, because I think sometimes people move to Chevy Chase, then move back to the district and back and forth. So there were friendship ties that across the district border for sure. But those two stars actually are just an artifact of the fact that we don't know the address of those two members, and I couldn't do it. But I know, for instance, the Teal family that lived on Cummings Lane. They lived in their house for some time, but then they moved back to the District of Columbia. Well, wouldn't you want them to come to a meeting, right? And he was a longtime member. And that's one of my theories about why they might want to leave the Chevy Chase Association, right? To have it be a broader endeavor.
Before we have the next question, if I could ask you to go ahead and fill out your evaluation forms and pass them to the middle. And Marianne, I think, is going to walk up with that. Then we can have questions and
then
we'll do it all.
Yes.
But Chevy Chase, D.C. has a lot of alleys. Even, and but yet they weren't allowed. So does that mean that...
Right, well, so Chevy Chase, D.C. also, not all parts, but many parts of it developed by the Chevy Chase Land Company. In D.C., as I understand it, they didn't have the same concern. Right? It was just for this exclusive suburb in Maryland that they wanted no alleys. It's a good question, yeah. And now, I mean, an alley is great, actually, but people's ideas, yeah. Any other questions? I think it's the farmhouse. It's not. So the first building would be the farmhouse. I'm pretty sure that this that photograph, we use it all the time from the Chevy Chase Club. But it's behind, but in front of that farmhouse. Yeah. Well, I hope that you will go to the online exhibit and enjoy reading these biographies. At your leisure, and you'll find lots of other funny, interesting things. Maybe new books to read.